Welcome back to part two of this Sonic Boom series with Adobe After Effects and the Boris Effects Suite. I'm Ben Brownlee, and in this section, we will create the basic sound waves using particle illusion and drive them using the data created in part one. So let's get going. Okay, well, let's make our first effect, shall we? And I'm going to apply a particle illusion effect, directly onto our girl. And let's launch particle illusion. Now, if you haven't worked with particle illusion before, particle illusion is as the name kind of gives away, it's particle generator system. And it's sort of, you know, a lot of it, the workflow is kind of preset driven. When you get it, it's thousands of presets that you can start to work with and draw from, you know, lots of different kind of fun particle-y type stuff. You know, and this can be as complex or as simple as you want. So what we're going to do here is actually do something very, very simple, very, very straightforward. And let's just change that to default so we can see everything here. And I'm going to make up my own little emitter very quickly. So I'm just going to type in the library, in the search, just basic, and I'll find my basic emitter. This really doesn't, you know, do a lot. It's the most basic emitter we can have. In fact, it's so basic, we've got two of them. So it doesn't really matter which one we take. So I'm just going to double click to load that in. Then I can change my layout to edit, so we get a bit more space here. Okay, if I press play, you can see our particles are very, very small, very, very slow, and very, very boring. So let's come in and we'll make a couple of changes on this. The first thing I'm going to do actually is just change our zoom setting. And the zoom setting kind of makes everything bigger. We do have size as well, but what the size does is change the size of the particles, but doesn't scale up the velocity or the speed of them in the same way. If we use zoom instead, that's going to give us the effect that we want. There we go. Okay, so the particle type also isn't quite what we're after either. We're going to have something a little bit more straightforward. We want something a little bit kind of rounder, a bit more sound wavy. So I'm going to open up my particle type and open up my properties. And I can easily change up my shape image here. Just by clicking on that icon, it brings us up into the library. And I can come in and I have a little look around, see if there's something that I like. And under the cartoon one, I just want something very cartoony, which is going to be ring 512. So it's just a really thin ring, 512 by 512. We've also got a thicker one there. You can import your own shape, but this one should be fine. Okay, so this is now giving out a load of rings. We do have the ability to render this out in 3D, but I'm just going to cheat it for this. There's really no need to kind of create this in 3D. So what I will do, though, is I'll just turn the opacity up on this a bit to 100%. And I'll take the velocity down to zero. So all these are doing now is they're being born. A little bit later, they're dying at at the same size. So that's why it looks like we've just got one single little particle there. So I'm going to come down to this thing called size over life, right down the bottom in the particle type. And this tells us what's going to happen to the particle size over the course of its lifetime. So if I bring this down to zero, all of a sudden, we now get nice concentric circles coming in. And at the end of its life, I can bring that up to 200. And we've now got a bigger value at the end of it, its life as well. So if I bring the size up now to around about there, that's being a bit more interesting, yeah? But this is just a kind of linear movement in life. That's not particularly interesting to me. So I can change this to something like a Bezier. And then I'll come to the end and make this one a Bezier as well. And so we can have a bit more of a kind of exponential curve. If you think that's moving a bit too fast, I kind of think it probably is. The only thing that we're animating is this size over life, and that's auto animating. So the only thing we need to do to make this one slower is actually bring the life up a little bit. So by bringing the life up, it's taking longer for it to come in and, you know, reach its full size. I think there's you know, that was going too slow, but I do think there's probably a happy medium somewhere, maybe even at 16. We can even add some sort of variation to this as well, but I think we'll just keep it like it is. That's probably going to be all right. The other thing we have turned on, the final thing we have actually to look at, is the motion blur. We had motion blur turned on, so that was giving us some sort of streaks. And we can see that these are quite steppy. If you didn't want these to be too steppy, then we can, you know, come into the project settings and change that up to maybe 12 or 16. Okay, maybe something like that. All right, let's apply that. Boom, boom, boom. Very nice. So we have our basic sound wave. We can do something more interesting than this, but I think this is going to be fine for now. The other thing I wanted to do before we bring this in, I'm going to go back into Particle Illusion again, is I want to come in and I want to preload some of these frames. So if I scroll down properties here, we have frames to preload. And what this does is it just kind of moves us a little bit further forward in the simulation, like 40 frames forward. So we start with some particles already on the screen. We want to keep this value quite low. We don't really want to be generating up particles we don't need, you know, but 40 is good. There we go. So now we have particles working right from the very beginning of our video. In the Particle Illusion plugin, we have transforms. We can also, because I said like these are 3D, we could also use like the 3D comp camera as well in After Effects, but we're not working in 3D. We'll make this easy on ourselves. And we can transform up just the emitter or just the world, which is like how the camera's moving, or the world plus the emitter, which is what we're going to do. And this opens up more options for us. One of those options being Mocha Tracker / Mocha. Aha. All right, let's open up this. And here's an old friend. So this is slightly different, very slightly different. Because when we open up Mocha inside a plugin, we're usually greeted with one or more, in this case, different effect trackers. So these are the parameters that we can easily connect our tracking data to. But we've already tracked this. So I'm going to come into File, and I'm going to go Merge Project. And I'm going to find that boombox track that I created, you know, 5 minutes ago, and open that up. And this now brings in our track data down here. So with the emitter offset, let's turn this over here. So with the emitter offset, I can now connect this to one of our trackers. Let's say we'll start with speaker right. And I can just bring my emitter offset point down to the bottom there. Now I'll scrub that through. My emitter is already sitting in exactly the right place. So we don't need to worry about tracking the emitter. So I'll turn off the cog on that one. I do want to track in the world though. And the world is just really about the kind of camera movement. And the reason I want to do that is because we have a moving camera. So our simulation, our particles are going to look better if we have a moving camera to track in the world, and if we have a moving object to track in the emitter. if we have both moving camera and moving object, we're going to track in both the emitter and the world. So with this, I don't need to do too much. I'm just going to come to our world center. I'll only track in translation. So that's the position X and Y. And I'll just track that one backwards. And this should only take a few seconds to do. And that obviously caused us no problems at all. All right, so let's come out here. And you'll see that immediately when I come out of Mocha, it's now applied our particles to our right-hand speaker. And because we've got the particles moving on the world as well, we get this nice 3D kind of look, this kind of tunnel look that we were after. That's pretty cool. Now I'm done with motion tracking for this, so I'll just close that down. Now the eagle-eyed of you will also notice we have Beat Reactor built straight into Particle Illusion as well. So if I turn that on, connect this to my music, you can see we've got the same options as we had previously, with one exception, and that's the ability to instantly connect this to like numbers or sizes or velocities. So we can use the Particle Illusion Beat Reactor to directly connect us to some of these other effects. Now, I'm not going to do it this way for one simple reason, actually, and that's because I've already got my music data as a slider here. If I wasn't going to connect my music data up to multiple effects, I would 100% just use the Beat Reactor in Particle Illusion. It makes it easier, and it makes it easier to sort of adjust things up. But I do already have this. So let's not make double work for ourselves. Let's just come into particle properties and let's connect this up to number. So I'm going to alt-click to create an expression. And then I'm going to use my pick whip. And I'm going to come down to my music data slider and just connect those values together. After Effects will do all the hard work of just typing everything, making sure that I don't have to type stuff with spelling mistakes. And I'll just enter on the number pad, and then I can RAM preview that through. And that will now change the number that's being created based off of the music. Okay, so we've got our first wave, sound wave. Cool, happy with that. Let's do one for the other speaker as well. Let's call this one particles speaker right. Just rename that one. And I'm going to duplicate this. And I'm going to call this one particle speaker left. And the only thing I'm going to change is in my Mocha motion tracker. I'm going to come in here. I'm going to come to my emitter offset. I'm just going to move that over. All the tracking data is going to be exactly where we need it to be, because that first track that we did was just so good. There we go. And now we have our sound waves going. They're identical at the moment. They probably wouldn't be identical in real life. I could hook this up to do different things for like the left and right channel. I'm not going to overthink this. I think it's going to be very easy to overthink it, but I'm not going to overthink it. I'm feeling pretty good about where we are right now. We have our particles created. We have our, you know, stuff still motion tracked in, and we have our music data null as well. Excellent. That's the end of part two. Join me in part three of this series, where we learn how to make these basic particles look a lot more fancy using Sapphire effects. Thanks for joining me for now. If you want to try this out on your own footage, then head on over to boriseffects.com and download a free trial version of all the software you've seen here. You can also learn more about the Boris Effects suite and learn through the hours of free video tutorials of all of the Boris Effects products.